Are you experiencing severe stabby pain in the heel or foot after getting up first thing in the morning or prolonged sitting? That's a classic symptom of plantar fasciitis. Hey everyone, this is Dr. Zach Nguyen here at Performance Sport and Spine. In today's video, we'll talk about this condition and the best way to resolve it. So your plantar fascia is located on the bottom of your foot, running from your toes to your heel or calcaneus bone, and it's comprised of dense connective tissue. So this condition is caused by a repetitive strain or overuse of the plantar fascia, causing thickening and or degeneration of that tissue. So a better name is probably plantar fascia pain, as inflammation is not the main driver and can lead us down the wrong path of treatments. Plantar fascia pain typically presents as stabby, sharp pain in the heel or plantar fascia, and it's always after prolonged periods of rest, such as first thing in the morning or after sitting for long periods of time, and usually gets better as you move around. So what are some risk factors for plantar fascia? Being overweight or obese can increase the risk, prolonged running on hard surfaces, limited ankle dorsiflexion, being females is a ratio of 2 to 1 compared to males, and then excessive high arch and excessive flat feet. So for these last two components, the operative word is excessive. So if you think of a bowstring as your foot, if your string is incredibly taut or incredibly lax, it will increase your chance for plantar fascia, but there's a huge amount of variation that's normally accepted. So it's really only at the extremes of that continuum that becomes problematic. So stretching has been proven to help this condition. So we'll go over some different variations. Now, the first one is the gastroc stretch, which is the superficial muscle on the lower leg. So keeping your knees straight with your toes up on a ledge, you're going to lean your body forward and to feel a gentle little tension over your posterior lower leg. And we recommend holding this for 20 to 30 seconds, 2 to 3 sets, one time a day, 5 to 7 times a week. Now the second stretch is the deep tissue. So it's the soleus muscle. So for this muscle, you need to bend your knee a little bit. So again, you're gonna place your foot up on a step, keeping your knee bent, and then you're going to lean forward, and you should feel the tension a little bit lower and a little bit deeper than the first one. And again, the same sets and reps apply. And again, you want to hold it with mild discomfort, but you don't want to push too hard or push too little. The plantar fascia stretch. So taking your shoe off, place one hand on the fascia where it's painful, and you're going to grab your first three toes, and with the opposite hand, you're going to pull back to tolerance, apply as much stretch as possible, and hold it for 10 seconds. And you want to work up to 10 reps for 10 seconds, 1 to 2 times a day. So a thing that you can do to kind of resolve the symptoms or temporarily help this condition is just roll your foot out on a lacrosse ball or a tennis ball, because it can kind of help eliminate some of the plantar fascia pain, as well as their small muscles that can also be the pain generators. And this will help with those more. And we'll discuss this a little bit more in detail later. Also, some people may find effective to freeze the ice in a bottle and then use that to roll. Again, do it moderately. If you do it excessively, it can cause further irritation down the road. Another helpful stretch can be using night splints at night. So these can progressively increase the dorsiflexion or stretch on the plantar fascia. So they all come in all sorts and sizes. So you may have to do a little bit of trial and error, but the goal is to over time increase the ankle range of motion and increase the intensity of the plantar fascia stretch. So now we'll talk about exercises, which probably is the best tool we have for fighting this condition. But before we do that, we got to talk about load management. So that's temporary, maybe reducing the provocative activity to let the tissue heal. So if you're a runner and you're running a ton and you're starting to get plantar fasciitis, just adding more exercises isn't necessarily going to help. So you're going to have to reduce the volume, let the tissues calm down, as this is an overuse repetitive strain issue, and then gradually build things up and increase the mileage over time. So it seems like calf raises are the best thing with that slow tempo. So you're going to stand on a step or a stair with your weight on the front of your foot, not your toes, and your heels off, and you're going to raise up for 3 seconds, pause, and then down for 3 seconds. And we recommend you start there and do this several times and see your body responds before progressing to the more advanced tiers. Now the volume will change for everyone, but we recommend doing 2 sets of 4 to 6 reps for 2 days, rest the third day, and if all goes well, increasing the reps on the fourth day, again doing 2 days, resting on the sixth day. So the second one would be just to do it on a single leg, again 3 seconds up, 3 seconds down, pausing at the top. Now again, progressing too fast is going to challenge this, so it's baby steps. Slow, continuous consistency is the way to attack this problem. Tier 3 would be to place something under your toes to add some stretch to the plantar fascia before the exercise. And again, it's just going to be a single leg heel raise, 3 seconds up, pause, 3 seconds down. And again, you should feel a little additional tension from that cloth or object under your toe, putting a little bit of excessive strain on the plantar fascia. And again, make sure it's slow. And then the final tier would be adding additional weight, like holding a weight in your hand, or even put weight in a backpack if that's easier. And again, small baby steps. So don't increase the weight too fast or it probably will flare it up. And again, make sure it's 3 seconds up, pause, and then 3 seconds down. So there are some other conditions that present somewhat similarly that we need to be aware of. So the first one we just calf tightness. Now this person would report that their calves feel tight all the time, and they probably have trigger points that would reproduce their pain if you push on them. The next issue would be Achilles tendon issues. Now this, the pain would be more on the heel. It would be reproducible with calf stretching, and the tendon itself would be tender to touch. The next would be the bone. So this would have calcaneal fatigue. The pain would probably be deep, and tapping your heels on the ground would reproduce the pain. Lederhose disease. So this would have nodules, actual growths on the plantar fascia on the bottom. They'd only be tender to the touch, and it would be a dull and achy pain rather than a stabby pain. Braxton's neuroma. Now this pain is worse in the night than the morning. There'd be probably numbness or tingling associated with it, and it would be inside of the heel. Tarsal tunnel syndrome. So this would be higher up than the previous condition. The symptoms would be over the entire foot, and there'd be a positive tarsal tap sign. So there are other treatments for this condition that we'll discuss now. So NSAIDs may provide mild relief, and they should be used in the short term, the smallest dose possible. And again, this isn't an inflammatory process. This is an overload degenerative process. So trying to tackle inflammation is not the right path. Ice is variable to the person, so try it. It may work, it may not. If it does, continue to do it. If it doesn't, then discontinue. So prolotherapy is where a solution is injected into the plantar fascia to try to promote healing. Now the evidence is mixed to poor, and so I'd only recommend this for severe cases and as an adjunct to exercise. So intracorporeal pneumatic shock therapy does have some evidence to support it. Again, this should be only used as an adjunct with exercise, and ultrasound is not recommended as evidence does not support it. And then lastly, a walking boot. Now this should not be used for most cases, but there are a few cases that may be helpful. So the first one would be a full rupture of the plantar fascia, as you have to completely offload it to let it heal. The second would be very persistent or recalcitrant issues. And then lastly, there's some occupations like waitresses that you just can't get off your feet, so a boot is necessary because you can't rest it enough. So for imaging, x-rays may help with bone, and it may identify bone spurs. But the thing about bone spurs is you got to think it more of tin foil than actual large bony growths, and it's probably a symptom of the problem, not the cause of the issue. And then ultrasound will be helpful in identifying the thickness of the plantar fascia. But again, is this defense or defect? Is the plantar fascia getting thicker causing pain, or is there pain and overload of the tissue causing the plantar fascia to get thickness? We just don't know yet. MRIs have some clinical utility, and if we're trying to address the bone, when you look at a bone scan, is that's the best to detect any bone stress. So injections like corticosteroids. So there is some evidence to show that they provide short-term pain relief, but there's also evidence to say that there's a long-term effect of degeneration of the tendon if they're used too much. So we would argue that they should only be used in moderation and only for severe cases that the pain is starting to limit the person's day-to-day activity. And then lastly, surgery. Like all surgical interventions, there should be a shared decision process between the patient and the surgeon, and it should only be tried after evidence-based conservative care has been tried and failed. Thank you so much for watching our video on plantar heel pain. We hope you found it beneficial. If you did, please like our video and subscribe to our channel as it helps us reach a larger audience.